Office of Parks, Recreation, Historic Preservation. So I am part of SHPO's survey and National Register unit. And so I handle essentially all of the survey, consultation, compliance, and National Register projects in central New York. So that's Broome, Cayuga, Chenango, Cortland, Madison, Onondaga, and Oswego counties. So if you're in one of those counties and you have questions from the State Historic Preservation Office, it comes to me. The sort of general tasks, the sort of general things that I cover in my position here with the Survey and National Register Unit is that I handle compliance consultation projects. So anything that requires a National Historic Preservation Act, Section 106, New York State Historic Preservation Act, Section 1409, or State Environmental Quality Review Act review. So that's sort of any funded project, anything that's receiving state or federal permits or funding, or has to go through a seeker review, State Environmental Quality Review, those come through me. I also handle any sort of surveys that are done for National Register resources are submitted to our office are reviewed by me. And I also handle all National Register nominations and the sort of determination of eligibility process for National Register nominations. So and I know in a lot of cases that's probably something that's very interesting to all of you. And then I also do all of the tax credits for the part one process for the New York State homeownership tax credit program and part one for the federal commercial income producing properties tax credit program. So those are, if you're not super familiar with the tax credit programs, I can give you a little rundown on those in a little bit, but they're three-part applications. So part one is essentially the certification that buildings are historic. And then part two is a technical review of like what your project proposals are. And part three is the sort of approval after a project is done to make sure that people can still get the tax credits based off the work they did. So very quickly, if you've never been to our website, we are actively sort of in the process of planning some major renovations to it that should happen sometime within the next year, I would hope. So the State Historic Preservation Office's website is parks.ny.gov/SHPO. It's right up here in the top corner. And when you go there, there's quite a lot of information that you can navigate on sort of the right menu here. Like if you have questions about the National Register program, you can click the National Register section. It sort of gives you a walkthrough of what the program is, how the program works through our office, and then the various forms that you can get access to or links to the forms. Same thing with sort of what surveys are and the survey process, and who conducts surveys, how to get funding for surveys and stuff like that. Various preservation assistance. There's, descriptions of the tax credit program, our archaeology unit. We have an archaeology unit that handles obviously I handle specifically above ground cultural resources. So like architectural, historical stuff, buildings, structures. We have an archaeology unit that handles the below ground resources. And then our contact section is probably the most useful part of this website. And it breaks everything down by unit. So like if you see here, it's the Survey and National Register unit. It outlines what we do. And then it gives everyone in the unit and the counties that they handle. And you'll see me here with, Broome, Cayuga, Chenango, Cortland, Madison, Onondaga, and Oswego, and my phone number. If you click my name or anyone's name here, it should bring you to an email. I would recommend, we are still currently, and at least for the foreseeable future, working only 50% time in the office. And so since we don't have state-issued phones for the most part, that's something that's hopefully changing in the next coming months, cell phones, we only have access to our desk phones when we're in the office, which would be, in theory, every other day, every other business day. So if you try to give us a call, we might not be able to get back to you for, 48 hours. So I highly recommend if anyone has any questions that they start with email. Because then even if it's just to arrange a phone call, if your preference is phone calls, you know, if you email me and say like, hey, I'd like to have a phone call, we can set it up that way. It's a lot easier than, you know, if you call in, I might not be here until, you know, till the next day. But yeah, so if you have any questions about any of those things, National Register, survey, the legal compliance aspect of what we do, or the tax credit programs, I'm your man. You can shoot me an email and I can provide you all sorts of information. We've got handouts, sort of like publicly accessible PDF document handouts that explain the various aspects of our programming. I've got sort of, you know, I usually like to do the sort of longer descriptions on how the processes work via email, because it gives people something to reference back to, rather than if I say it over the phone, they have to take notes and all that. It's nice to have it in a written format. But yeah, we have a bunch of documentation and stuff like that. And the other thing that I wanted to tell you about, which I think is very important for all of you as public historians out there, if you have not used it before or are unfamiliar with it, we do have the New York State Cultural Resource Information System, which is how we sort of run all of our, pretty much everything runs through that at this point. And so we call it CRIS, C-R-I-S. And if you go to our website and click online tools, CRIS, it brings you to sort of a walkthrough of what CRIS is and what its different systems are. But you can also go to CRIS, CRIS.parks.ny.gov, and it will bring you right to it. But so I wanted to sort of really quickly show you all CRIS if you've never used it before. I can't see all of you at once with the screen share happening, but you know, do any of you use CRIS regularly, or are any of you completely unfamiliar with CRIS?
That would be yes.
Unfamiliar or?
Unfamiliar.
Okay, are familiar. Okay. But so for those of you who aren't familiar with CRIS, if you go to CRIS for the first time, you'll be sort of prompted with this sort of terms of service. Just, you know, if you click agree, I would recommend, for in most cases, you can proceed as a guest. You don't need to have like an actual sign-in. You can get an actual sign-in. It's useful if you use it like every day. But if you're only going to use it, you know, occasionally, a couple times a week, and you're not going to use it to really be submitting a lot to our office, it's easier just to proceed as a guest. But CRIS essentially lets you, using these sort of top navigation bars, search for, like in a lot of cases, search is a very useful function. So, you know, we've got a homepage where you can search for any existing projects you might have submitted to us. But if you don't have projects open, you can submit projects to us in any of these various categories, such as a consultation project for the different legal reviews, like I said, an independent survey, if you've had someone go out and do, you know, collect inventory forms and do a survey of like an entire municipality or something like that, you can submit independent surveys. I would highly recommend before you do a survey that you reach out to me, and then I can sort of give you the guidance on how we would approach that and go through the submission process, because we do have a new system called Trekker, which allows you to just do sort of surveys in the field, or allows people to do surveys in the field. So if people come to you guys and ask about surveys, send them to me and I can give them the whole sort of process on how we work through that. We do third-party evaluations of eligibility if there's approval from the owner. We do National Register applications. This is sort of a little misleading here, because the National Register application section is more of a application as far as like a determination of eligibility for the building. So like if you select National Register application, you can submit a building to us, and then we will determine if that building is eligible for listing on the National Register. And then from there, if it is, I would reach back out with like the nomination process, which is, you know, I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar. The nomination process is quite extensive. And then sort of, if you just have random things in your community that you want to submit a one-off inventory form on, we've got that. You can submit that. And then you can also, the big one is search. So we've got a whole map section here where you can do either a search by sort of existing projects or National Register listing names. If you know a building's listed on the National Register, if you know the name of a building, we call all sort of resources in this USNs, universal site numbers, they get a USN number. or unique, I think it's unique site number, sorry. But you can search by like a street name or house number for anything that we might have in our database. But you can also do spatial searches. And I actually think it's easier. There's a little tool up here on the map, the little green radar button. And you can just type in an address. Like if I type in 625 Broadway, Albany, which is the DEC building, the main office for New York State Parks, I can just click locate. And it will bring me to downtown Albany with all these fun lines, which you can then turn off in various ways. So like right next to the little green drop down, there's this little drop down with sort of bullet points, and it's got all the things that I'm looking at right now. So, you know, for the most part, you wouldn't need consultation projects or probably even building surveys. But so like if I shut that off and the archaeological surveys off, you can see here, this is the downtown Albany Historic District, every building in the downtown Albany Historic District. And they're sort of color-coded based off of what they are. So 625 Broadway has not had a determination of eligibility done by our office, but everything that's in yellow is listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Everything in green here has been determined eligible by our office. Everything in red has been determined not eligible. And if you come up into the opposite corner, sort of the far right, there's a base map drop down and you can switch different layers. So like this is the orthographic imagery. And you can see sort of like the Google view of the entire community. You know what I mean? So like this is downtown Albany. You can go anywhere in the state and see every resource that we have in our database. And so what's important to sort of consider, and this is part of what my job is that we don't have every resource in the state in the database. And so part of what we do is try to collect all of that data so we can get it into the database where the public can access it and learn more about, you know, certain buildings and districts. Like for instance, if I click the downtown Albany Historic District and click view, it'll load a page here where it has sort of information about, it shows the boundary, the status of like when it was listed on the National Register. And if you go to attachments, it has the National Register nomination. So that's like accessible information. If there were any building inventory forms for individual houses and things that were submitted throughout the existence of the State Historic Preservation Office, for the most part, anything that we had had when this system was created in 2014, I think, was digitized and put into CRIS to be available to the public. So like, you know, somebody can come here and see the original. I believe the downtown Albany was 1989, but this is the actual nomination from 1989 for, with all its descriptions and the list of all of the buildings and what the buildings looked like and all that sort of stuff. And so if you have a historic district or an individually listed National Register building in your community, this form is in there. You can get the forms accessible. And any other information that we have on the buildings, a lot of more recent buildings will have photographs attached. So you can see sort of some, if we have historic photography, sometimes those will be attached in CRIS under the photos section. In this case, like this entire district has photos, but they're not under the photo section of the tab. And then you can also look at, if you're looking at a historic district, if you click, you know, every building in it should be in the USN's tab. So like this is all of the buildings, and you can choose a building, you know, the one at random, but the Renaissance Albany Hotel, there's a picture of it. It will bring you to its location on Eagle Street. There's photos of it. Like this is a photo from the 1970s versus, you know, more modern photography. And there's an old building inventory form for it also. So if I just pop that open real quick, you can kind of get the idea of what you can see as far as various places around the state. And in a lot of cases, for the most part, you know, anything that's on the national, everything that is on the National Register of Historic Places should be in this database. And I believe it is, to the best of our knowledge. So it's sort of a nice, easy way to sort of find what we already have and what's already listed. See, here's the old building inventory form from 1975. You know, with the photo then and that sort of stuff and information that they took in, you know, 1975 about the buildings. And so if you had, you know, if in the past people had done that sort of things in your community, we've got that information. So that's CRIS. And I work pretty much extensively through Chris. So like these submissions I was talking about is really all of the things that I process. And then also the tax credit program, which is not done through Chris because it's, you know, there's various like tax liabilities with having people's social security numbers and TIN numbers and stuff in the database system. But so how the tax credits work is essentially there are two tax credit programs in New York State. If you're not familiar, there is the New York State homeowners homeownership, New York State historic homeownership tax credit program, which is for if a house is listed on the National Register of Historic Places, people can get tax credits to do qualified rehabilitation on those houses. And so there's a sort of application process for that that we work through. And then there's also the federal, which works sort of in conjunction with New York State SHPO, my office, and the National Park Service, a federal income producing properties commercial tax credit program. So if there are, you know, businesses in your community that are looking for, that have, that are working with, you know, historic resources that are listed or eligible for listing on the National Register, or are potentially eligible for listing in the case of the commercial program, they can submit a part one application and we can work through the process of, you can actually get the commercial tax credit program before a building is listed on the National Register, so long as it's eligible for listing and it gets listed within 30 months of the building being placed into service. So that's very useful for like developers and, you know, New York State. We just got data from National Park Service that New York State did, I forget the exact number, but it was, well, I think, you know, I could pull it up on my emails if you give me just a moment. A lot of money in the billions range as far as how much money sort of went into communities using the commercial tax credit program. And New York, we process more tax credits than any other state. So that all comes through our office here. I know like I did, I think close to 100 last year. But the, so yes, there are, you know, the tax credits are something that's available to your communities to utilize. And that's really the primary sort of financial incentive that we have in New York State for motivating preservation in communities. There are grants available if you are a certified local government. I don't know if anyone's familiar with the certified local government program. I don't really handle that, but I can give you the contact of the appropriate person in my office who handles that. But there are sometimes grants available. They come up, the applications come up once a year. I think it already passed. It's usually around the fall. And you can get access to sort of communities that are CLG, certified local governments, and that's a process through the National Park Service, can sometimes get grants for things like funding surveys of their communities and stuff like that. So yeah, that's, again, you know, I'm James Carter here at the State Historic Preservation Office, and that's what I do. So it's a pleasure to meet all of you in this digital space. Again, I apologize. I don't have a camera set up here, but I have to wear my mask in the office anyway, so you wouldn't really see much. But the I think that's it. And I am open for questions if anyone has any specific questions they want to ask. I don't want to take up too much time.
Anyone have questions? Go ahead, Lane.
Yeah, I have a question. When you're talking about the tax credit program just for individual homeowners, does that cover outside buildings like barns?
So not usually. However, there is a barns tax credit specifically for barns. And I don't handle the barn credit, but I can give you the contact for who does. It's sort of an odd program. It's specifically through New York State. And it runs entirely through our office with sort of in conjunction with New York State Tax and Finance. And it's changed dramatically over the last couple years. The legislature sort of changes how it functions in some ways. And I am not entirely up to date on it. But so there is a barn tax credit. So if someone has a barn and it is historic, I believe our office, SHPO, certifies that they're historic, but I believe that's changing. I think there might be a specific date. It used to be back in the day, it was like any barns that were older than a certain year were eligible for this sort of barn rehabilitation tax credit. That changed. I think it's reverting back to like a specific date. But so if you shoot me an email at james.carter@parks.ny.gov, I can put you in touch with Olivia, who is our person here who handles the barn tax credit. And she would be able to sort of better explain that credit program.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Any other questions for James?
Hi, James. I just wanted to say hello. Beverly Sales from the town of Victory in Cayuga County. And oh, I completed the CRIS form for our history center.
Yes,
so just wanted to say hi.
Hi.
Anybody else with a question or a hello?
Yes, I see some, as I'm scanning through here, I see some names that I'm familiar with. I think I've interacted with some of you before, which is nice. So it's nice to put a face to a name. I'm sorry that we can't do the opposite at the moment. But.
All right, James, thank you very much for taking part today. Folks, if you want to get a hold of him, he sent his email, but I can also give it to you. We appreciate you taking the time and effort, and we'll take like a 2-minute break and I'll get Susan set up and we'll be going again in just a second.
Yeah, thank you.
So Susan, if you're ready, you should be able to share your screen to see if Jesus goes off.
Sorry, I need to stop sharing. I apologize.
Oh, it's okay.
All right.
All right. Let me get into. There we go.
All right. Round two.
Okay.
I feel like we haven't talked in like 3 weeks, and that's like 6 years compared to what we were doing earlier this summer.
I hope everybody can see my screen okay. I figured rather than do some types of slides and so forth, I just wanted to show you where to find things on our website, because I think that's part, you know, a lot of times we get phone calls, people not exactly sure how to do something with one of the applications. And so to me, you know, what's really important is we've got so much information on our website, and I want to help you find where it is, because sometimes we do have updates. So those of you who may be new, I know I see a lot of familiar names, but if you're new, I'm Susan Hughes. I'm the historian and archivist for the William G. Pomeroy Foundation. And I am in charge of the Historic Marker Grants program. We have a team of historian researchers that work with us. I know a lot of you have gotten markers from us in the past or attended some of our workshops, which we used to have in person, BAFNIs, and now we have a lot of things online. But we have, if you're not from, I just want to go through the different programs we have, because some of them may be new to you, even though you might be familiar with, say, for example, our National Register program or our New York State Historic Markers. So one of the things I really wanted to point out to everybody that you might not be aware of, even if you've had a marker from us and maybe it was a few years ago when you got it, is right here in the center, this marker map. We have, if you get a marker from us, you will have a presence on our marker map. And the marker map is interactive. And there we are, the United States. Every program that we give markers to every marker has its own web page on our website. So for example, if you wanted to see, maybe you have one of our blue and yellow New York State markers, you can hit filter and search. You can, These are all the different marker programs that we have right now. So for example, you know, let's just go to New York State. And they always, it's like, yeah, where's New York State? There's New York State. So we zero in on the state, and then we can also zero in on, say, for example, let's just put in Madison County. Okay, let's just Madison County Health Department. I mean, if you wanted to see if there was one in the area, you can do it 25 miles, you can do 10 miles, you know, it'll take you in, and then you just hit your results. And here's a marker in Peterborough that we have. If you click on the little red pin, here, for example, is one that we gave out in Madison County 2019. If you click on Learn More, there it is. There's the webpage for that. It gives you the it gives you some photographs. These are the photographs that the applicant sent us. They also submitted a photo from 1938, so we add that to the page. We have a little bit of description. You know, some have more description than others. And here's the information over here, the exact location and the GPS location of the marker itself. So I would suggest, you know, you might not be aware of this. This is a good thing you can use. You know, you're welcome to link to it, whatever, if you have your own webpage for your municipality or your historical organization, you are welcome to link to our marker map. The other thing is, it's really good for finding examples of how you, you know, it may be inspiration for what marker for markers that you might want to put in. You know, has anybody done a children's home before? Well, you can look on here and find, get some inspiration as the type of information that was put on there. Okay, so that's our marker map. If we go back up to celebrate history, you can see of all our marker programs. And let's go, for example, to one of our new ones that you might not be aware of because it just came out last year, is our Hungry for History. And this is to celebrate American food history. We're interested in foods from your community, not necessarily commercial. We don't do commercial. So for example, we wouldn't put up a marker for, you know, the Nestle's chocolate factory that used to be in Fulton or something like that, because that is a commercial product. However, we put up things for like salt potatoes, which, you know, we might put up something for Utica greens. We are all over the United States. We just approved a marker at our meeting this morning for a dish called Sonker, which is down in West Virginia. And it's basically kind of a sweet potato or fruit crumble, more or less. So some of these things, you know, could be, you might say, well, you know, it's a pie, everybody has pies, but it could be something unique. We had one for an election day cake out of the South. We had one for another type of cake that has bourbon in it that was mentioned, that's out of Kentucky. And yes, it's a cake, you know, every community has cakes, but this was something specific that traditionally is made on election day in this particular county in Kentucky. So that's the kind of things that we're looking for with the Hungry for History. And there's lots of information here. We have primary source documentation. You go down here, here's your application deadlines. There's two grant rounds in 2022, one of which opens in will open in January. So that's one of our newest ones that we really, you know, we found that people are really excited about. We're really excited about it because we're getting a lot of, you know, fun markers for that. We also have our Legends and Lore, which has been around for a few years. A lot of you know them. There's some in Madison County. I'm sure you're very familiar with them, but it gives you some inspiration as in terms of, you know, what exactly we're talking about with folklore. So we have some information here. This one is also nationwide. So if you know somebody from another state, or perhaps you have a vacation home in another state and you know of a folklore or a legend or lore from that area, that you'd be interested in, you know, contact the local, historical society or municipality and see if they might be interested. We also have, and we just talked about National Register. So if you're not familiar with this, we have our National Register program. So if you get one of those National Register designations for your property or your historic district, we will give markers for not for private properties. So if it's for your home that's on the National Register, we do not give markers for those. However, if it is owned by a municipality, the county, or a 501c3, so for example, your historical site might be in a National Register building, we will give markers for those. We will give markers to a municipality for a historic district. Obviously, that's going to have some private commercial buildings, some private homes in it. But seeing as the municipality or the county is the one who has to apply for the historic and designate that historic district, we'll give a marker for the historic district if the application comes from that municipality and the marker's put on public property. So a lot of times there's, you know, a local park or even the town right away, you know, it could go in. And there are actually three different kinds. You can get a marker on a pole. You can see an example here. Or we have two different plaques that you can pick from. And the plaques are actually very popular with churches because they like to put it either on the front of the church or perhaps maybe, you know, in the vestibule, the public entryway or a community hall or something like that. So, you know, it's your choice of the three, which you would like. We have Patriot burials. Now, this is something that a lot of you might not be aware of because this is in partnership with the New York State or Empire State, Sons of the American Revolution. So the applications do need to come through the Empire State SAR. However, they are very open to partnering with people who might send them suggestions. And what we're looking for is burial sites of Revolutionary War patriots. Those could be, they could be soldiers who died in action. They could be veterans of the Revolutionary War. They could be people who were in civil service of the Revolutionary War. Any patriot who would qualify as a patriot under the Sons of the American Revolution designation would be eligible for their burial site to have one of these markers. You can see here where there's ones in Evans Mills, and they were able to identify 12 Revolutionary War veterans interred there. The markers are fairly standard. They do have the Empire State Sons of the American Revolution logo at the top. If you know of a cemetery with Revolutionary War patriots buried there or a Revolutionary War patriot buried there, and you're interested in one of these markers and you don't know anybody in the SAR to contact, please contact our office. You can call us, you can email me personally, Susan@wgpfoundation.org, or you can just send it to our general info@wgpfoundation.org, and we will put you in touch with the gentleman who is our liaison with for this Patriot Burials Program through the Sons of the American Revolution, and they're very happy to get suggestions from local historical societies or individuals. It doesn't have to be a municipal cemetery. It can be municipal. It can be private. It can also be a private family burial ground, which we've had quite a few, which, you know, are in the more rural areas that are still on, you know, a farm that the family owns. And they've got maybe a couple dozen, you know, private, you know, burials there. We have put those there as well. The only thing we ask is that the location does need to be visible from the road so that we can place the marker along the roadside so that people can see it. And our other requirement is that we don't want people to have to cross private property in order to get to the cemetery. For example, you know, there are some Fairview burial grounds that, you know, possibly have been neglected over the years, and they might be buried off in the woods, and you would have to cross a couple of acres to get there or go down through the woods and you can't see it from the road, and it would require you trespassing on private property. We won't award a marker for that because we want to be good neighbors. We want all of us to be good neighbors. And, you know, if you can negotiate something with the property owner, that's one thing. But if you can't, then it needs to be something that's along the side of the road. But again, if you have questions about that, please contact us at the office. And we're happy to put you in touch with a gentleman named Dave Powell, who is our liaison for this program. And they are happy to take suggestions for cemeteries. And we do get a lot of questions about why don't we do this with the DAR? And I just want to mention that it's because the SAR contacted us about partnering with them with this program. So it's and we actually have ideas for how we'd like to partner with the DAR. So the New York State DAR is going to be hearing from us. And we have a great relationship with them. We've done some other things with them in the past. And we have some ideas for a different type of marker program that we'd like to do with them. So. Historic transportation canals. Of course, we all think of the Erie Canal. This is a nationwide program. So there were a lot of abandoned canals around, not just the Erie Canal, but there was the D&H Canal, which sections of it were abandoned in New York State. It goes down into Pennsylvania. Our furthest, if that's grammatically correct, our most remote marker, let's put it that way, our most remote marker for is a canal marker that we have up in Alaska. And it was a canal, it was a transportation canal, but not for boats, it was for float planes between two lakes in Alaska, and it allowed for takeoff and landing of planes during the Second World War, and it continues today, so it is considered a transportation canal. But these, you know, you might have canals in the area that are, that, you know, no, you don't even realize it's canal, you know, there's a ditch along, or sometimes, for example, this one is Route 97 in Highland, where, you know, Route 97, as you know, we know, if you're in downtown Syracuse, you're driving on the Erie Canal sometimes. So here's a case of this section of Route 97, you're driving on the D&H Canal. We do also do important structures for the canal. We've done a couple, one or two lock tender houses. We've done a lock tender's house that was also a country store that still exists. It does need to be, there does need to be something there that you can see. If the canal is completely gone and there's nothing there to see about it because maybe there's houses over top or something. You know, in this case, yes, it is it's a road over it, but you can go on the road and imagine that this, you know, this used to be the canal. It also needs to be visible from the road, again, that you can get to it without crossing private property. We have had a couple that unfortunately were off. You can't see them from the road. You would have to trespass on private property. And again, we want to be good neighbors. So we don't want to give out markers that annoy people because suddenly they've got everybody tramps into their backyard to see what used to be a canal. So that's what we're looking for with those types of canals. So let's see, I think I went through all of them. We do have, we do partner with other states for marker programs, and we have done some with other state or other non-New York State organizations with particular, they want to do a marker, say, for example, right, we're doing some markers in North Carolina for the Civil Rights Trail. If your organization or your municipality has an idea for a particular trail that you would like to do, next year I'm going to be talking with some folks from Oneida County about a possibility of an underground railroad trail in Oneida County, because there's been a lot of research that's done there. If you have thoughts about something in particular that you would like to, a historical event that happened in your county, say for example, and you've got a number of different 5-10 different locations, and you would like to make that into some type of a trail, we'd love to hear from you and talk to you. You can contact me directly. You can email us at our general number. You can also talk to, you can also call and ask for Jim Keib. Jim, and his last name is Keib, K-E-I-B. But if you just want to call and say, I'd like to talk to Jim about a possible marker program, Jim is in our office 3 days a week, and he would be happy to call you back and chat about it and see if we can work something out, get some ideas and so forth. So that's pretty much our market program for right now. We're region 7 through 9 right now is open. So you would have for one of the blue and yellow New York State historic markers, the deadline for the LOIs is Monday, December 13th for that. The canal markers, again, all of these are on the website. We have canal markers opening in April of 2022. The Hungry for History opens at the end of January 2022. All of these have one or two rounds a year. So at this point, I'd be happy to answer any questions about the programs itself or, you know, applications or so forth. Like I said, I know I see a lot of familiar names here today. So I know a lot of you have applied in the past.
No, I just wanted to say very quickly from, you know, New York State Historic Preservation Office, thank you to the Pomeroy Foundation. Mm-hmm. You know, fantastic signage, your website and that map with the various resources is a fantastic resource for the public. And also, this is the first time I'm hearing about the Hungry for History program. I know some colleagues will be very excited about that.
Oh, good.
So thank you very much.
Good. Can we send you, is there anything we could send you in terms of literature or anything for the New York State marker, for the National Register marker program? You know, as you're giving them out, if you want to let them know.
So yeah, we do generally when people, because whenever we list stuff, people always ask about the signage. So we usually do defer them to the Pomeroy Foundation. You're one of the people that we mention as far as access to signage. If you would like to send us stuff, I don't know when the last time we received things. I'll reach out to you. I'll get your email address. I'll send you an email.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you, Jim.
Susan. This is Diane Van Slyke, and I have Kirk Stalter here with me. She's not on camera. Mm-hmm. She wanted to know if you allow markers within the cemetery at an actual grave site.
We do. A lot of it depends upon it. Will it be visible from the road? So if somebody's driving past, can they say, "Oh, look, there's a marker there. I'll pull it. Let me pull in and look at it." So those are really done on a case-by-case basis, but I won't give you an absolute no. I'd say we'd certainly consider it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Susan. This is Mike Beardsley of the Town of Sullivan.
Hi.
I was wondering, do you know if the SAR Patriot program, does that partner in Pennsylvania?
We are currently no. However, we are reaching, and the Jim Kive that I mentioned before is reaching out to all the different state SAR organizations and inviting them to join in this program. So if you have anybody that's in an official capacity on the board of directors or an office or anything that you think would be good boots on the ground for us to, you know, help promote this program, we'd love to hear from them. Because we'd love to be able to have somebody there to partner with. Right now, we are on the verge of partnering with the state of Kentucky. We just met with them yesterday, and the state of New Jersey. We just need the official okay from the board of directors in order to go ahead with it. So if you know somebody in Pennsylvania, you know, have them contact me or have them contact Jim. The other thing about the Patriot Burials program is you can see that the example that I gave you, it has the Empire State logo. We will put that state's logo on the marker. So Pennsylvania, you know, if SAR has their own logo, they will get it on their markers.
I see. That's very good. Just another follow-up question. With the SAR Patriot program, do they limit that to Revolutionary War veterans, or do they also include 1812? I know some of the 1812 groups have gone belly up or closed.
Mm-hmm.
So they're kind of alone out there. Do you know, do they do 1812 or no?
For the Patriot Burials, no, it's just Revolutionary War. However, if you have a cemetery where there are, you know, especially some of those small cemeteries where it might just be, you know, a family cemetery, but that, you know, veterans buried in a cemetery and other notable people would fall under our state historic marker program. So we do have some of the blue and yellow markers that mention that there are War of 1812 veterans buried there. And Bill Pomeroy is very interested in that because he did lose an ancestor in the War of 1812. So he's very interested in getting though, especially those, you know, abandoned or not, you know, something that maybe it's an old family cemetery that has been abandoned over the years and the town has taken over and there's no markers there at all. You know, he's very interested in seeing those get marked.
Right. Hey, thank you very much. Okay. Appreciate it.
Susan, quick question for you. I submitted a Legends and Lores in the last go round, and what is the date that it's supposed to, sometime in December they're supposed to mm-hmm. announce?
Let's see.
Or December, did I say September?
You know, I don't have it on this one. I can find it for you real quick. So you applied, did you send it in August? The August one
yes.
that opened up? Yeah.
Yes.
So August, she has on here. I think it's supposed to be December 2021. Unfortunately, I think there's a typo. She put December 2022. So it should be this month, which, you know, which, what was the title of yours? And I can check on it.
I think it was called, I think I titled it How New Hope Got Its Name.
Oh, okay. Oh, wait, okay. Got its name.
Or New Hope.
When we're done here, I will check on that and reach out to our consultant who works on those and just ask her that you were asking about it.
Okay, appreciate that.
Sure.
What's her name?
Are you also doing the New Hope Mills?
No, this was a Legends and Lore about the town of New Hope. The mill already has some markers. And Susan, this is another question for you, because you said we could link markers, the existing markers, to your marker map, even though they're not Pomeroy markers. Is that what you said?
No, we can't. We won't put the non-Pomeroy ones. But if you are, you know, if you have a website with that information on there and you want to link to our marker map to give people more complete information, you're welcome to link to our map. But we can't put the ones that we didn't award on our website.
Any other questions for Susan? All right, Susan, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. And if anybody thinks of anything, shoot us an email, give us a call. We are in the office 3 days a week. We work from home Mondays and Fridays, but we have access to email. So email is probably the quickest way to get a hold of us.
You want to stop you? There you go. All right. So I'm just going to go over a couple of things real quick. You should have gotten an email yesterday about membership renewals. It's really beneficial for us if you actually sign up and pay for a membership and not keep taking advantage of what we do for free. So we'd appreciate that. If you got questions about the renewals, you can contact me or you can contact Ray Lefevre. His information's right on our website, who handles most of that. I have talked to a couple of folks already about different things. We did have an in-person conference in Oswego that for the most part went pretty well in September. We also had it virtually. With this one, we only did one live stream because it was a new process and it was quite costly for us to do. We are going to be, I'm going to try and share my screen here. We are going to be back doing that next year, September. So I think you all see what I'm looking at here, which is the Kingston announcement. So it does look like we're going to at least attempt to live stream all the presentations. Not 100% sure on that yet, because again, some of it depends on cost. It was north of $4,000 to just live stream the one set of events. So the live stream both, that you can kind of guess that's going to be a significant volume of money, but it does seem like we may have some leads on helping us offset some of those costs. So I would encourage you to do that. In regards to our spring meeting, I am not 100% sure on that yet, mostly because I'm not 100% sure what I'm going to be doing at that point. I have a book coming out in the spring, and I'm probably going to have to go around and do some book tour stuff. So plus, Lord only knows what's going to be going on with COVID at that point in time. So we will, at the bare minimum, do something like this. I would. The church we were going to have it in, gosh, 2020 seems so long ago. The church we were going to have it in Cortland County in 2020 has said they will host us whenever we're ready to do it. So that's probably what would happen again if we did that. But again, I probably won't make an announcement on that. Normally I make my announcement right after the first of the year. I don't think I'll even think about making an announcement till February to see where we're at. Just because if the guidelines change, that obviously changes what we're going to do. With that, I'll open it up to you guys. If you guys have any questions, comments, rude remarks that you want to get out off your chest.
Yeah, Matt, quick question from Mike here. I know we all just got our dues notice. And in looking at the invoice summary and whatever, I can only find where you can pay via credit card. Now, that's fine with me, but the town of Sullivan insists on writing a check and going through the formal check request process. In the three-page email, I don't see a place to send the check. So do you know, do we send it to Zachary?
It's Zach Student-Roth, but if you look, we made an update because a few people asked about that already. So if you look at, now I got to find it, and if not, I will forward you the email. There is a form you can download and fill out that has the mailing address, but I'm gonna look and see real quick if on the join page, I thought they were gonna move the one part above, but it doesn't look like you did. We had a conversation and he was changing it today. So I will send you the form that you can download and has all that information. If anybody else needs it, it's a link, but I don't think it's an active link because it just doesn't seem to pop up naturally. So I will get that to you, Mike. Does anybody else need that while I'm doing it for Mike? I know I had to send it to Jason's clerk already. So yes, Cheryl, Sue, that. Hang on. Now I got to get a pen. Hang on. So I got Mike, Cheryl, and Sue Greenhagen.
I'm going to give this to the village.
Anybody else has to have that? Joan Prindle. Anybody else?
I do, as does my clerk and everything, Jan.
Yeah, I already spoke with her yesterday. She was taking care of that. Anybody else beyond Jason?
Charlie Albee.
All right, Charlie.
Yes, and Diane Van Slyke.
Okay. So what this will be is it'll be a form you can just print out and it should have all the information you need. That's what we've been doing. Like I said, I'll see if I can get them to actually put it up as a separate part of the webpage. Because Ray did say he was getting a lot of people asking about it. Anybody else?
Marcia Powell.
Marcia, get you.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, me too, Lane Gilmore.
I also had a question, if I may.
Go ahead.
Notice on the invoice that it says 2021 as opposed to 2022.
It's 2022. He just didn't change it.
Okay.
Matt?
Anything else? Oh, go ahead, George. Yep.
I got this.
Yep, that's your invoice.
And then I also got this.
That's the printable one.
Okay, so which one do I send to you?
It doesn't, if your town will pay with credit card, you're not sending it to me, first of all.
Well, yeah.
If you want to pay with credit card, you can do it right online. A lot of places like my county pays with credit card now. They don't want to do the voucher system anymore. So if your town wants to pay with credit card, you got to do whatever process they do, and you can do it right on their website. If your town has to do a voucher setup, which is what these folks are talking about, you fill out that other sheet, give it to your town, and then they'll mail a check to AFNES.
Okay, well, what I'm going to do, I'm going to pay for it personally and then submit an invoice.
Well, you do whatever, you leave me right out of that one. I have nothing to do with how you pay.
I just want to make sure that we send back the right form.
Right. I would give that to your town because that's probably what they're going to want, some form of thing telling where it's going and what it's for.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. All right. Any other questions for me while I'm here? So one more thing I want to ask of the folks that do this. If there's people or organizations or things that you think I should include as presenters, Susan is always very gracious to take part. James was gracious today, and we've had, you know, archives and the library and different organizations of Cornell. But if there are organizations that you actually think we should get that you feel would be beneficial to us as historians, let me know. I have no problem reaching out to people. I have had people turn me down, but that's generally pretty rare. Most people are very willing to come out and talk to us. And sometimes people, I'm a pretty linear thinker. So sometimes people that think a little differently than me have good ideas. Normally my ideas are the best, but we'll go with that other people can think very well. If you have organizations or people, especially if it comes to stuff like, I know a lot of people ask me about grants, which there really isn't a ton of grants right now, but there are organizations out there that do stuff. The caveat would be it'd have to be something that could benefit our region. So like every now and again, somebody will ask me about the Hudson Valley stuff. That really doesn't benefit our region, so it doesn't make sense for us to do it. If you know of stuff like that, you know, let me know. Sue, I see you popped off.
Yeah, I attended the New York State Preservation Conference earlier this year, and they had a speaker talking on how to do oral histories. You know, you think it's so simple, it's self-explanatory, but there's really a lot more to it. And I would suggest a program on oral history.
I think that's a great one. I do a lot of that, so I agree.
Yeah, I agree with Sue, because right now the two of us out here in Skaneateles are putting together a walking tour of the business district of the village. So something like that would be very helpful.
Well, I'll actually tell you, James is still here. I've actually used, a historic district, if you have a historic district, if you've ever looked at those, that is the easiest way to create a walking tour ever. Mm-hmm. Because you literally have pretty compiled histories of the building. And then if you're even luckier and you have the buildings with the dates on the top of them, now you can go and find out a whole bunch of information in about half an hour's worth of time, and you got a walking tour all set up. So especially a place like Skaneateles, I'm fairly certain all of Skaneateles is a historic district, at least the village. I'm wagering that if you look, you'll probably find a ton of information. And that's one of those rare situations where I wouldn't promote this often, but Wikipedia actually normally has the links that you can click on that'll take you right to the preservation bios. It doesn't always work, all right, so Jessica says, the San Mateo Historical Society is a great presentation on the upcoming release of the 1950 census. Yeah, that comes out next year, 2022 at some point. That will be released, barring shenanigans, I suppose. Thank you, April. All right, there you go.
I have a thing, if I may.
Go ahead.
One of the things that we're looking for here and everything is how to make our own archival boxes using appropriate materials and everything, because being able to make your own in-house is far less expensive than having to have, like, say, the Gaylord or Archival Supplies make them and provide them and such. We're currently looking to try to find a program or a way to do that. Because Syracuse University used to offer one, but they don't anymore for several years now. Is there interest among the other historians in that as well? Because if so, I can, once we figure it out and everything, put something together for everybody to see and learn.
Any interest? I think that's one of those, why don't you figure it out, show us, and we'll kind of go from there.
And you also, if I jump in on that, you might also want to contact the DHP, the Documentary Heritage Program, because they might have something already put together on how to do that.
Thank you, Susan. As the DHP?
Well, DHP is for museums. I would actually tell you the New York Archives would be the responder for that, since we're local governments.
Right, but the DHP is funded by the New York State Archives.
Right.
So you can, so they have, I mean, if you're, you have a group like this, they do things, they do different webinars and things for groups.
True.
So, I mean, if you have people from, yes, it is, it was run by the library. You don't have to be a library. I mean, they do things for historical societies and so forth.
Right.
So, you know, if you want to put together a group, they might, you know, be able to offer you some type of a webinar.
We've had them present.
Do those kinds of things.
We've had them present. They presented when we were in Onondaga County, not far from Skeeny Atlas. I can't think of the name of the town. Lake. Where's the lake, George?
Spafford?
Spafford. When we were in Spafford, they spoke with us in Spafford.
Mm-hmm.
So. Anything else?
If I could jump in one more time, James Carter at Shippo. I forgot to sort of mention this, but yeah, if there is like a large interest in your communities. We do have an entire community engagement sort of unit that deals with largely with questions about like the homeownership tax credit. But like if people in your communities, if a large number of people have questions or are interested in taking advantage of the tax credits for, you know, because you have a historic district or something like that, you can also reach out to me and we can arrange. It's been very difficult with COVID, but you know, in the before times, they would go out and have, you know, give presentations and stuff to, you know, we can go out and give presentations to communities. We can do digital presentations to like the public, not just you as historians, but like, you know, we can make public meetings to sort of present things about like the tax credit program and stuff. So that's just, you know, if you ever have interest in your communities about that, you know, feel free to reach out.
Thank you. All right, I got to hurry up and get going because I got to go see Joan in Hamilton in a little bit. So I will be talking to you all soon. Have a wonderful holiday. Thank you for coming. Thank you to Susan and James for doing this today. We really do appreciate it. And if you have questions and you can't get a hold of them, let me know and I'll get you their contacts. Oh, and I just see Ruthie at the end. Bye, Ruthie. It's good to see everybody.
Thanks, Matt.